Welcome to this detailed look at Gibson Assembly. Daniel Gibson developed Gibson Assembly as a technique for the in vitro assembly of exceptionally long clones. It is conceptually quite similar to infusion cloning. Both techniques allow seamless, scarless fusion between appropriately designed PCR fragments. They are both sequence independent and hence extremely versatile. The key difference is that the Gibson assembly reaction results in complete DNA molecules. There are three main steps when performing your Gibson assembly experiment: linearizing your vector, PCR amplification of your fragments of interest, and the Gibson assembly reaction. The first step in Gibson assembly is to linearize your vector at the insertion site. Any vector appropriate for the downstream experiment is suitable for Gibson assembly. The two main methods of vector linearization are restriction enzyme digestion and inverse PCR. Vectors may be linearized using restriction enzyme digestion with either one or two enzymes selected to cut at the insertion point. Inverse PCR has become a common way to generate a plasmid backbone for cloning. Primers amplify along the length of your chosen cloning vector, incorporating required functional elements for plasmid growth and replication. After successful Gibson assembly, your fragment of interest will fill the gap between the primers. Single insert Gibson assembly requires a PCR reaction that amplifies the insert of interest and adds the necessary nucleotides for annealing to the vector. You can achieve this by designing PCR primers containing two parts, the template-specific portion and the vector-specific tail. The template-specific portion of the primer amplifies the insert of interest and should be oriented with the 3' end of the primer facing into your target sequence. Standard primer design guidelines should be followed for this portion of the primer. Each primer also needs a vector-specific tail, bases that will anneal to the exposed ends of your linearized cloning vector. The resulting PCR reaction creates a PCR product containing the insert with the ends that overlap the vector. Multi-insert cloning works in a similar way, except that now you need to design the overlaps to match the adjacent insert fragments as well as the vector. The length of the homologous tails depends on the insert size and the number of inserts being incorporated. For simple Gibson assembly reactions, overlapping tails from 15 to 30 nucleotides are sufficient. As your fragment increases in length, you should increase the length of the overlapping tail. This rule applies to the number of fragments too. As you increase the number of fragments in your assembly, the length of the overlapping tails should also increase. SnapGene allows you to customize the length of your primer tails based on the specifics of your experimental design. After amplification and cleanup, you are ready to start the Gibson assembly reaction. There are specific Gibson assembly reagents optimized for smaller fragments and high fidelity, and some reagents that can fuse as many as 15 fragments to create complex constructs up to 1 megabase in length. When your fragments are ready, combine them with your chosen Gibson assembly enzyme mix and incubate as directed, usually from 15 minutes to 1 hour. Because Gibson assembly results in covalently joined fragments, excess incubation is not a problem and can benefit larger or more complex reactions. The Gibson assembly in vitro reaction involves the coordinated activity of three enzymes: T5 exonuclease, high fidelity DNA polymerase, and ligase. The T5 exonuclease chews back the 5' end of the double-stranded DNA to expose engineered overlaps. Exposed complementary single-stranded ends anneal, allowing DNA polymerase to fill in the overhangs, preventing excessive exonuclease activity. Ligase completes the fusion of the DNA fragments to create the final product. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.